So we're back, and we decided that we wanted to make a video talking about our life experiences leading up to our decision to have VSG, to have bariatric surgery. I've always been overweight. I don't know life without being overweight. But you know, growing up, there were definitely experiences that I've always had where I was had to buy bigger sizes than my friends, or I remember being younger and my grandmother would take me shopping and we'd have to shop when I was in elementary school, shop in the like adult section. And just having certain things said to me that now, as I'm older, stick with me, even if they weren't meant to be malicious at the time. Like some of the things, if I were to say it to my family members, they'd be like, what? Like, that's not what I meant. I didn't mean to make you feel this bad 20 years later. Like, that's not, I would know that they would feel that way, but it's still stuff that has stuck with me. So all of that kind of led me up to wanting to look into the surgery and knowing that I cannot do this without that tool. I know it's physically possible, but the probability of me becoming a healthy weight and a healthier version of myself without doing the surgery, I know is, the probability is very low. So that, all of that stuff from my childhood is what led me into wanting to look into it, wanting to go to the consultation, and trying to make a real decision on if I wanted it or not. So I don't know if you had experiences like that when you were younger.
Oh, yeah.
If you did, would you like to talk about it?
Yeah, so it was a lot of the same thing. When I was a kid, I have a cousin, but she's almost a year to the day older than me. I was always taller, but I was always bigger. And so anytime we'd get gifts and maybe someone would switch the same outfits, because that was very common for us to get the same outfit and have matching this and that, mine was always significantly larger than her stuff. And it was always obviously known to the entire family that Allie's set's gonna be the bigger one. I've always been tall. It's always the tallest person in my class. Always. Me and my friend. We were both the tallest, always. And her and I still, I think I'm taller than her now, but up until middle school, we were always the tallest. And like, I just have memories of being the first, we were both the first kids to be 100 pounds in our class, and our gym teacher weighed us in class in elementary school. So it was like fourth grade or sixth grade. It might have been middle school. It might have been sixth grade. And he announced everyone's weight to the entire class and had you get on the scale in front of the entire class. And her and I were both the first ones to get over 100 pounds. And I remember feeling so embarrassed and mortified that the whole class knew what my weight was and that I was one of the biggest, not just tallest, but heaviest kids in the class.
I was like 13 maybe, and I had just gone, like just starting to go through real puberty, and me and my mom went on a trip. We were staying at her friend's house, had a pair of pants on her couch, and she grabbed them and she was like, whose pants are these? I've never seen these before. And I was like, they're mine. And she was like, there's no way these are yours. These are a size 5. You don't fit into a size 5. And I was like, no, really, those are mine. And I had to literally put them on to show her that they were my pants. But because of how big I was, she didn't believe that they were my pants. It was like, no matter what size I was still the fat kid.
And I love all the body positivity stuff, because that wasn't a thing when we were younger.
No.
Like, there was no body positivity movement. There was no pride in who you are and just loving your body for what it was. We were taught, if you're fat, you punish yourself. I should find this notebook, because I still have it. This was written in 1999.
Eat more tomatoes.
Eat more tomatoes, lose more weight. These are my New Year's resolutions as a child. Like, could barely read and write. Like, it's all misspelled and stuff. And my New Year's resolutions were to eat more tomatoes, because, you know, they're healthy, and lose weight, exercise every day, drink more water, blah, blah, blah. And it was just, when I read that for the first time as an adult a couple years ago, I had found it in an old memory chest or something, it just shook me. And it made me so sad that even at the age of 6 and 7, I was still consumed with the same stuff I'm consumed with now.
Now that you know a little bit about our childhood and past and leading up to, you know, wanting to actually look into this, and I don't know if you've watched our previous videos, but if you haven't, you should. We talked about, I said that going into the consultation, I was 50-50 deciding on if I wanted to do it, and I left the consultation feeling about the same way. And, you know, we had a definitely difficult time with the consultation, I feel like, and the aftermath of it, just like wrapping our heads around it. So we wanted to tell you guys about our push to the actual yes, our push to the decision, and what, for me, what pushed me over the edge. And I said earlier that I am the heaviest I've ever been in my life, ever. Even 9 months pregnant, this is the heaviest I've ever been in my life. And we had our consultation in June, and then we have the carnival, the fair carnival goes through our town in July. And we decided we go every year. I buy a ton of tickets for my kids and we ride rides. This was the first year that all of my kids besides my baby could go on the big rides. And I wanted to go with them. Well, we decide to go on one of our favorite rides, and this ride has been one of my favorite rides since I was younger. And you know, I get up there with my kid in tow, and I get into the seat, and the guy's like, I had to jump up into the seat, like jump into it, and the guy goes to push it and it won't click, and he literally says to me, wiggle that thing back there, wiggle it back. And I'm like, this is embarrassing. And then he literally had to like slam me into it to get it to click closed. And mind you, this ride's like gonna go up in the air and like spinning and stuff. And I'm like, great, he just had to force this thing shut on me. Like, what if it comes undone? Everyone on this ride just saw me have to be like squished into this because I'm so big. And then I text her about it and was like, that was unpleasant. That was not a good experience. So what do? I go back the next night and decide to put myself through that all over again on different rides, because I'm like, surely it's just the one ride that has the thing coming over you. It's just so tight and, you know, they need you to be snug in there. No. No, guys. I went on a spinny ride that has just the fabric belt that is like super loose on everybody. It literally just hangs in front of you and you get stuck to the wall, right? Well, I'm on that ride and the guy had to help me close the thing. I'm just big and it wouldn't fit around me. So the guy gets it on, we go on the ride, and when I'm getting sucked against the wall, it's obviously looser, right? Well, then at the end of the ride, the carnival ride worker didn't come back onto the ride. So there I am with my 6-year-old son next to me, stuck in this ride, and I could not get the belt off. And here's my 6-year-old trying to get the belt off with me. And, oh, mommy, I can help you, I can help you. And we're trying and trying, and I couldn't get the belt off because it was so tight around my big belly. And this big, tall guy that was on the ride too came over and had to help me get out of the carnival ride, some guy who was riding it. And it was so embarrassing. It was just so, I can feel it right now just talking about it. It was so embarrassing to have my son next to me trying to help me get it off and having some random person have to like get me out of the ride. It was so bad. And then after that, so the first time I didn't cry. After this time though, I went and sat on the bench across 30 feet from the ride, and I sat there, my whole family was with me, and I sat on the bench and cried. And it was at that moment that I was like, nope, this is it. I have to do it. It has to happen. I cannot live like this anymore. I can't have my kids seeing stuff like this happen. I can't feel this heartache ever again that I've let myself get to this point where I don't have anything else to do other than cry about the fact that I'm letting my family see me go through these things in life. So it was at that moment that I was like, I literally went from 50-50 to all in. That was it. That was my experience. And it was the last time I was ever going to let that happen. So that was my over the edge. That was my over the edge experience. Did you have one of those?
Yeah, actually, the first carnival ride she talked about, that happened to me also. And the guy says, "Okay, mama," literally, this is verbatim, by the way. "Okay, mama, try to scoot back as far as you can." And I'm like, yeah, okay. So I try to, no success.
I know, I've scooted back too.
Scoot back, you know. And then he steps back and he says, "Okay, on the count of three, I need you to suck everything in. And if it doesn't latch, I'm going to have to ask you to get off." And I was like...
He said that?
Uh-huh.
I didn't know that.
I was like, breathe. You're not the first one who's experienced this. It'll be okay. On the count of three, and he pushed it in and it latched. And I was like, thank God. Because I think if he had told me to get off the ride, that would have been the worst.
Oh, biggest walk of shame ever. That would have been... I would have cried. I would have cried right there on the ride if that would have happened to me.
Yeah.
I almost cried on my ride.
Yeah.
That was my over the edge ride.
It was horrible. And then... yeah, just the last... There hasn't been anything quite like that second ride experience for you. Just this last year where I've been motivated to get stuff done and do stuff. And it's like it's never enough. And I just feel like every time I do anything, I'm just a failure.
I know, I felt like your letter, your Kyler letter was something huge for you.
That was big. Yeah. So for Mother's Day, ironically...
Good intentions, by the way.
Yeah,
this kid, he
was 7 at the time.
Yes, and he's has extremely a heart
smart.
Of gold.
He's extremely sensitive, very sweet, like empathetic human. This is
a
not
good
a reflection
kid.
On him. Yeah,
this is a good kid.
Kids are just honest. That's just how they are. And he made me this book for Mother's Day. And it said, "I love my mom because," or "my mom is," whatever. And it started out okay. It was beautiful and smart and, or, beautiful?
Beautiful, yeah, I don't know. It was cute. The whole thing
so
really
cute.
Was cute.
But then he said, "not funny, she's okay, and bossy, and."
Was it bossy?
Yeah. And, it was busy.
Busy
or bossy. It was, he said, the way it was spelled either looked like busy or bossy, and it ended up being the other. So I can't remember which order. And just, you know, never plays with me and all this stuff. And I'm like, that's really how he sees me. And then I'm thinking, you know, he's like, "you never want to play football with me and you never want to swing with me." And I'm thinking to myself, I can't run with you. So he's taking it as like not good quality time because... He wants to run and play soccer, which in our backyard, I totally do with him because it's a small enclosed space and I can keep up. But I'm like, I can't run for long periods of time and I can't, like, swings hurt my hips and my butt and I can't fit on all these things. And, you know, it was good to see. It's definitely made me more intentional about spending quality time with him because it wasn't that apparent to me until then that, he really doesn't think I spend any time with him, which isn't true at all. But
His perception
is that I don't because I'm not physically outside doing those types of activities with him. And so I was like, man, if I can't get my act together and be healthier and be able to keep up with them, then he's going to have this idea of me. Like, the seed has already been planted in his mind, and it's just continued to grow and grow until I do something about it. Like, this is a me problem, and I'm actually really thankful for that. I kept it. I have it in my drawer still, and I probably always will, because it was, yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because it was definitely a wow, eye-opening. I want to be the mom that's, you know, like doing 5Ks with her kids just for fun. Not that I have a desire to run a 5K, but I would, if my kids want to do that, I want to be able to have the choice and not just say, I can't. It hurts. Or
make a fun memory like that, like the superhero 5K that they did, or the color run one. Like just a fun memory where it doesn't
just
have to be
anything
a run.
Physical that they want to do. I want to be able to keep up with them and have a good time and not be miserable and hurting. Like, you know, our knees hurt and our back hurts and blah, da, 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 because we have all this extra weight. And it's really affecting, it really does affect your parenting. And when you're in that negative mindset too, it totally changes your perception of doing things with your kids, because you're thinking of all the negative stuff you'll have to endure. We want to do things and we want to pursue things in our life that are going to enhance our future forever.
Yes.
You know, and just to be clear, we do understand surgery is not going to be an end all be all. It's not just going to be easy weight gone. No,
no,
we know we're going to have to work harder than the average person, especially nutritionally.
Yes.
And we're willing to take that challenge because we have a lot to lose and a lot to gain.
We do.
So
it's true.
We're really excited to take you guys along with us though. We're having a lot of fun, and it's actually really therapeutic to be able to kind of talk some of this stuff through. And then, you know, when we go back and edit these videos later, we're like, wow, we've had a really fun time kind of discovering things about ourselves that we don't see because we don't watch ourselves talk.
Right.
So
we're gonna have to make you guys a blooper reel.
Oh yeah,
it's amazing.
It would be epic. All right, well,
thanks.
Most of these videos
us.
Are probably gonna be made in the car because it's just a good time to talk.
Yeah.
We have 6 kids, one of which is 2, and the oldest of them is 11.
Yeah.
So it's,
the car's our safe haven.
Yeah, and it's a circus at both of our houses at any given time.
True.
All
Truth
of our
bomb.
Kids have big personalities, and none of them are like quiet and shy. Really?
No,
so.
If we were doing this with our kids, they'd be like, "Wah! I want to be in the video.
That's what my daughter says. She's 5. I want to be in the video.
Chris would legit be like, "Soda bomb."
Mm-hmm. Or she'd be, what is that thing called? She'd be flossing the whole time.
Oh, man.
No, is anyone else sick of the floss?
Oh, dude, we have the Kiki challenge going on right now. Kiki.
Yeah, she keeps wanting me to do it, and I'm just like, no. No, no.
Thank you guys so much for watching us. Make sure to like and subscribe. We're gonna have more content coming out. I know we've said that friggin' 1,000 times, but we're gonna keep saying it.
We're excited.
We're excited. So I hope that this has helped somebody kind of with their journey and how they're gonna navigate their yes or their no. Mm-hmm. Whatever you decide is totally 100% okay, and always be okay with your decision.
Yep.
So you'll know, you'll feel it in your gut, and thank you guys for watching.
Sending positive vibes out to you. And if you need anyone for support, we're always here.
Peace,
virtually.
Love and VSG.
Peace, love, and VSG. Woo!